Yeah. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, or good afternoon, depending. So thank you for the invitation to be here, and I think the Ramsar Convention is really wanting to partner up with you river restoration experts, and I'll tell you a little bit why. I'm starting with a picture which I took last year in a small city in Europe. I don't say where it was, but it seems to be obvious that we still are a too small group, and not every hears the messages coming out of this expertise pool here on how to do river restorations and on how maybe not to do. But so there's still a lot going on from the past. So that the message is, our message is actually, let's be bold and let's try to bring our experience, our knowledge also to wider areas, to those actually who take the decisions, who do affect our rivers and our river floodplains. So I'm trying to build a little bit up on this. A few weeks ago, the WWF and others have published a Living Planet Index, where even if it may seem that we have enough water here, there is actually a problem of not having enough water anymore in many of our rivers. So water scarcity is becoming a problem, and across the world, probably more than 200 river basins will experience diminished amounts of water, and over 2,000 million people, that means 2 trillion or billion people, depending on American or English, depend on those rivers in drier areas. But closer to here also, many of the glaciers are about to melt. What is happening then in summer when there is no more glacier meltwater coming from down the Alps or so? So let's clearly identify that we are not just about doing the technical work on the ground, on our small scratch. We are working on really essential issues which are essential for our society, for our politicians who take the decisions. And that is also the message, obviously, of the Convention on Wetlands, where the rivers in the concept, on the wetland concepts, which was developed in the 60s of last century, are quite a central element, a central infrastructure in the hydrological cycle, because through the rivers, at least the surface water flows from the glaciers to the sea, and they are obviously linked with the underground water as well. We know what the issues are, and I'm focusing specifically on the water-related issues, and the ranked list which was published by the European Commission and the EAA a few years ago is probably still relatively similar in the ranking. It's the water quality, but it's also obviously that rivers don't have enough space any longer through drainage. Too much water is used for non-sustainable uses. And then the channelizations, etc., etc. I'm not going through it. You know it. We know it. But we have to explain this maybe a little bit more to other circles. After all, what many of us feel here at their heart is that we are feeling about the ecosystem, the nature behind it. So the first argument to those who can support our work, but obviously would eventually support also better rivers and better and river restoration leading to that, is bringing back the water where we took it away. This picture was taken a few kilometers from here. It is a construction which dates obviously from the end of the 19th century when the big drainages were built. Nowadays we have maybe better ways of doing so, but again it is up to us to tell those who will otherwise construct concrete sluices. An argument which we should not forget, and even if you're working on our own small stretch, it's the whole river basin we are concerned about. It's the upstream, downstream links, and the floodplains, the wetlands in the floodplains connect us all. So the longitudinal flows, let's not forget about the longitudinal flows in a river basin, along a full river, be it small, be it big, be it the Danube, be it a small tributary, But this is where the thing's happening. We had the debate is ongoing about hydropower, and now with the moving to renewable energy, the pressure will be increasing from the mountaintops to the lowland parts of the big rivers. That is obviously linked to the migration corridors for fish, obviously, but for birds and for others. And also, unfortunately, invasive species migrate very easily through river corridors. So another challenge where probably we should, which is a good argument about getting further support for our work, that we can deal with invasive species, be it plant or be it animals. And restoration of entire floodplains is a big challenge, and this is something we should be maybe advocating more, not necessarily with either or. I'm a little bit struck by this defensive attitude here. Oh, we are losing, or the others are the bad guys, or so. Why aren't we not looking for win-win solutions? Why floodplains are increasingly turned into temporarily flooded plains, which when they are not so flooded, they can serve for other purposes, like this is, for instance, in the Iser Valley, mainly in Belgium, but also shared with northern France. So there are agricultural and other uses which are compatible with win-win situations. And obviously, that is a main subject on the lateral flows, which I think we need to also to speak to the local and national decision makers. The surface groundwater interactions are becoming more and more of an issue. We have good hydrogeologists and institutions who work on it. More and more it's coming into the political scene, and I think that's certainly where our work will be and can be evaluated in the futures. We've heard about the hydro peaking, minimal flows, flow fluctuations, and things like this. This is the challenge, especially in the upper parts of the river, where obviously the flows are rapid and maybe completely 100% abstracted for energy production or else. So let's be bold, let's work and promote these issues, our knowledge, our expertise, but showing that there are probably compromises which will be interesting for all involved stakeholders. It was mentioned a little bit, and I think we are advised to work more on that subject, is the valuation, the economic valuation. This is a report the Ramsar Convention has prepared with the TEEP group, TEEP for the Economics of Ecosystems and Biodiversity. They have a small team under UNEP who works on several follow-up reports, now also mainly on agricultural-related valuations. And therefore, I think the field is still very large to do more calculations, not only putting a monetary value on anything, on all things, but also not be shy about speaking about intrinsic non-monetary values, the values that it still exists, that the beauty exists, that the species also exists, which at first sight might not yet have a price tag at them, but sooner or later one may find out about some monetary values anyway. A big issue which maybe we should also thinking about is more linking the upstream services with the downstream users, so and making maybe the downstream users willing to pay for what they get from upstream. So that these are arguments which I think are arguments which help us for bringing forward our engineering, our restoration work at our local pitch of our local river stretch. And these are likely arguments which will be heard by the politicians and the decision makers who say where the money goes or what way rivers will be restored or not restored. And also, as I showed in the first picture, maybe the investments of money are still too often wrongly directed. So we have strong arguments to direct those who make investments into better ways of investing their money. So because maybe often natural solutions, our solutions are maybe cheaper, And also our argument, which we should be forward, that not doing anything may actually be worse than trying to restore something. We had 4 times incredible flood along the Sava River during this summer. It won't have been the last time. Next year, another river has its turn or so. So the issue is really supporting our work. So the Ramsar Convention has adopted some guidance on the more strategic level and how to plan restoration, what for, where to do restorations, how to deal with the constraints, and then how to do the restoration. So just to explain you that there is a convention, a political field which can help your engineering, your technical work to be spread and to be applied wider, and therefore obviously we would like to exchange more with your expertise, invite you to share it with us, and vice versa, to have the Ramsar people, a few of them are in the room, to share, to get into more contact with you from the restoration side, because there's a lot of exchange and in both ways, and a lot to be gained. A few of the analysis done most recently from our side was that 2 ecosystems which are most in need for restoration, it's riverine floodplains, once in the lowland. The upper picture is from the Pripyat as an example, and the other one in mountain areas. This is the entrance of the Alpine Rhine into Lake Constance, so obviously rather the lower picture, everything which is further upstream and similar rivers here in this catchment of the Danube catchment. Just last week in Tirol, in Kufstein, the European Ramsar parties met, and they did have a few presentations from the Sea River projects and from other, and were also looking at these upstream restorations on the Drava, for instance, which has just become a new Ramsar site in the upper Drava in Ostia, but also the Mura and other issues are obviously very much a common issue with the people in this room and those who have been from all over Europe last week in another room. As I said before, maybe natural solutions are cheaper. They don't have to be as cheap as this one, but this is a quick fix and what was actually quite effective, at least at the short run. The Ramsar parties have also elaborated quite a methodology to help restoration people to link the local restoration project with the whole river basin catchment. And the catchment planning, it's called the critical path. It was inspired by a method originally developed in South Africa, and this is available for further use. I don't go into detail, but just to let you know that it exists. It offers a kind of a roadmap, which is based on implementation experience, which lists the obstacles which often we encounter. They are often similar or comparable, and argues that one should go step by step, progressively initiate activities, becoming active, and also give the link from basin scale down to site scale or vice versa. Transboundary basin cooperation is increasingly becoming important. There is a specific also sister convention, the Helsinki Convention, working on this, and there is obviously steps how this can work from at the beginning, maybe only unilateral work on each side with contacts and then regular consultations down to shared activities, joint even administration, and even shared personnel or resources in the best cases. So again, to reinforce the message that the rivers and the water-related ecosystem in a wider sense are really at the heart, at the nexus, providing the link between the main drivers on the policy scheme now, after Rio Plus 20, and now when the new sustainable development goals are under discussion and will soon be adopted, that between needs of the humanity for water resources, but also energy and food. So these rivers and the ecosystems which go with them and which they are really providing a link for sustainable development and natural resources management. Often flood alleviation is the trigger which gives us some money, which gives us some support, but let's not be shy to use these opportunities to think about the other objectives as well and create synergies between different objectives, add benefits and reduce costs by addressing them all at the same time rather than once after the next one. So there is a list of them in the bottom part of the picture. I don't have to go through them, you know it better depending on each case. So, but I think the message I'm hearing more and more is that it is urgent and it's coming urgent to engage with other sectors. Maybe we from the environmental sector are still a little bit too shy to do so. The energy does it, the industry does it, the transport does it. We may think, okay, this is just greenwashing or so. Maybe it is not, maybe it is more than that. And we have good arguments also to be as bold and as outgoing in the same intersectoral discussions and should be more visible, more present at such meetings and debates to exchange our know-how, our experience and really find the solutions to work with the others. These are obviously the main pressures. The pressures won't go away, they will be coming worse and worse. Because we are still more people living in Europe, more people with a finite amount of land, of surface area, so we need more energy. We do want to have more transport and navigation, even if it's not necessarily the best possible solution. Urbanization, more than half of the world's people are living in cities now, and this is an increasing trend. And migrations of our migration, but also of animals, is important, and the extraction of gravels and other soil or minerals is a pressure which we want to deal with, and within a context which I think we have to repeat again and again, that sustainable rivers need space to retain floods, space to recharge the groundwater, space also for the nature and the biodiversity which goes with it, which brings indirectly other services to us, society. River culture, let's not forget it. Make that link, and I've heard a few examples, which is great. And of course, the leisure aspects is very important and is a driver. Who of you would have thought that this picture was taken at Munich, at the Isar River? So this is 1 kilometer from the city center of Munich, and this is a very good example which exists since at least 10 years already. And therefore, not only we care about river restoration, but the population at large has interests in this in these recreation and leisure areas. So that is what the Ramsar Convention can help river restoration experts with, bringing this message back to the politicians, to this political scene, and that's where we obviously invite also your expertise from the direct engineering, natural bioengineering, from the restoration techniques, to bring this in to support these political arguments with technical and scientific substance, to show the pure water managers that there are ecosystems behind, and that we can provide this ecosystems approach to water management. We have now a window of opportunities because so far there did not exist a global governance scheme for water governance, but now the situation has changed since last year, since this year. There are, in principle, three global conventions, agreements, treaties available to deal with water management. There is the Ramsar Convention, who comes from the ecosystem angle and can obviously support those concerns. The oldest one of them, there's the Helsinki one on transboundary lakes, groundwaters and rivers, with whom we are working a lot together, and who has a number of very practical instruments, elaborated a lot of expertise and does a great work, and has opened up to the whole world outside of the United Nations Economic Commission for European region, so the pan-Europe, Europe and Northern Asia, if you like, essentially, so it's open for the whole world. And there is the most recent one, which was signed in New York at the UN General Assembly in 1997, which has now sufficient ratifications by countries, but it has not yet operational structure, but together, I think together we can do a great job, and we will do a great job, and this can be the outlet for the technical and engineering know-how and expertise of river restoration. So that was shortly our messages and our invitation to work more together. Thank you.
How will be the process of the wedding? Sander is here, they counted, I think, so it's up to you. Yeah, you have it over there.
Okay, so I won't be long before lunch. I have the honor now to announce the poster prize winners, and this is obviously going in the same line of thinking, that it is important not only to do the good things, but also speak about what we are doing and speak to those who need to know more. Therefore, communication in all forms is important, and communicating through posters is one way, and therefore we felt it would be a nice incitement, support or game, or also to let you choose the posters which you liked best or so. The prize is rather a recognition of that effort, and I think in a more practical sense we would like then to really support those three winners to spread their message wider through the Ramsar channels of communications, to making it wider known, and trying to see how we can work together on those points I mentioned before on spreading the message through other audiences also. So based on your votes, and I thank you for the team here for the conference who have calculated this in a record time and provided me with the results. So the three top ranked ones, and I'm starting with the posters who got was in position three. And this is the poster which is titled "The Challenges and Practicalities of Reinstalling Hydromorphological Processes in a Heavily Modified Water Body." It's number six. Is the author in the room? Okay, please come forward, and I will hand over to you also a book, and then ask the three winners to be in contact with me after that. We exchange the addresses that, as I said, we can make work together to make the contents, the idea, and the knowledge behind the poster more widely used, recognized and known.
Thank you.
And then on position two is a poster which has the title "Hydraulic Impacts of Wetlands Along the Submerged Weir Removal in Rivers." Is the author here? Okay, yes, please. That's one of our Asian colleagues, and that's great. And then the posters who got the most votes is one which is called "Wetland Management in Slovenia." The other two books were actually books about wetlands across the world, the Ramsar sites. As this poster has wetlands in the title already, they get a book which is called Freshwater.